Recording.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, thank you for bringing us all together tonight to share a meal and learn more about you. Please watch over us all as we seek to deepen our relationship with you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Many of you will remember our speaker tonight. He was ordained in June of 1996, so feel those years passing. He was first assigned to Queen of All Saints and since has served in 8 parishes in our diocese. He's currently serving as the Director of Spiritual Care at St. Anthony's. So speaking tonight on the joy of love is Father Bill O'Toole.
Thank you. So I have no idea, I've never done this before here, but I have no idea how many people to expect. I only have 30 copies, so you're going to have to do a lot of sharing out there. And I just thought, even if there's a lot of people that come, for raining out like this, that you wouldn't, but you're amazing. So you won't be disappointed, though, because the document that we are going to look at tonight, The Joy of Love, you've all heard a little bit about. If you don't even follow the news, you've probably heard about it. You might not have actually seen it, like I have it in my hand, or read it, which I really encourage you to do. But this is probably the most publicized document that is in the public eye. The most press was given to this of any document, certainly of this pope and perhaps of any pope. So I say that because there's a little bit of controversy here with this document, okay? We'll talk about that, but then we'll get to the heart of the matter in just a moment. But I know we already had our prayer, but one of the things that Pope Francis does in this, and so if you have one of those pieces of paper that I handed out, I ask you right now, to turn to the side, The Joy of Love, Amoris Laetitia, the Latin. And rather than that is a reading from St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians. So what I'm asking you to do, if you have it in front of you, is to try to read this together. We'll read it nice and slow, line by line, but it is a beautiful passage of Scripture. And one of the things the Pope does in this document is he kind of breaks it down in a way that I've never seen it explained ever before. So if we could read that together again, if you have this in front of you. If you have it memorized, you could do that too, right? But in case you don't, hopefully you could get someone to share with you one of the copies that we have. So again, this is a reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians together. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not jealous or boastful. It is not arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrong, but rejoices in the right. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. So that reading you might be familiar with. It's very, very popular among couples. Many, many people choose it for their wedding. But I'm afraid that because we hear it so often, it's one of those ones we really don't pay attention to. We dismiss or we think, well, I've heard this, I know this. But I don't think that I knew it anywhere near as much as before I read this document. Oh. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize there were instructions without any instruction video. Okay, I should ask, can everyone hear? If you can't hear, don't raise your hands. Can everyone hear? Okay, I'm still not getting the... So maybe it is the mic. It was okay before. One more time. Who can hear? Okay, now, that's more like it. All right. I don't know. I couldn't go past the line. I won't, okay? I promise I'll behave myself. I'll try. All right. Okay, so we'll go back to that passage in just a moment, but back to the famous or the infamous part of this document. First of all, a word about our Holy Father, about Pope Francis. He is amazing. It is incredible for us to have a pope like him, and I think it's a lot to do, some of us were just speaking of this a few moments ago, because of where he's from. We've had many, many popes throughout the years from Italy, as you know, and many others from different countries in Europe, like Pope Benedict, right before this one. But this is the first one ever in the history of our church that is from the Americas. Now, you might not think that Argentina is very close to the United States, and it isn't, but it's a lot closer, in a sense, culturally, than the other countries where popes have been from. So he sometimes speaks in a different way or does things in a different way, and I think that has a lot to do with the fact that he is an American. And sometimes we don't think of that. We think of the Americas as the United States, and we're part of the Americas, but all of this hemisphere, all of North and South America, of course, are part of the Americas. Well, anyway, he has a gift, many gifts, but one of his gifts is that he knows how to get people's attention. He knows how to get the media's attention, and this is a great thing. Because before him, there's probably many people in our world, many of them who even are Catholics, who never really picked up a papal document or read it or even thought about it. But that's not the case now, because what Pope Francis writes and also what he speaks gets a lot of press. And I think for the most part, this is a good thing. Sometimes he's misunderstood, but everyone in the press is misunderstood. So, that being the case, I just want you to, if you're one of those lucky souls, one of those few and far between, that have a copy in front of you, at the bottom of that front side of the page is chapter 8, okay? It's not the whole chapter, it's just one of the articles, okay? One of the parts of that chapter. And that's kind of famous. If you Google Article 305, you don't have to put in Pope Benedict, you don't have to put in Apostolic Exhortation or Catholic or anything like that. This will come up because a lot of people have looked this up. This is where the controversy is, okay? And this is what, not what tonight is about, but it's good for you to be aware of this if you're not. And a little bit of clarification, because the media's had a lot of ideas about what Pope Francis was trying to say here. I can't speak for Pope Francis, but the media apparently does, or thinks it can. Anyway, so, if you have that in front of you, just read that quickly. The Article 305, this is from Chapter 8 of this document. Because of forms of conditioning and mitigating factors, it is possible that in an objective situation of sin, which may not be subjectively culpable or fully such, a person can be living in God's grace, can love, and can also grow in the life of grace and charity while receiving the church's help to this end, okay? So we're using some big words in there that need a few words of explanation, but actually that's not the most famous part. The footnote is, okay, so right after that it says 351, if you again have one of these copies in front of you. So here is the famous footnote, one of the most quoted papal speech or papal writings, perhaps in the history of the church, at least by the media, by other people outside the church. So the footnote of that little article from chapter 8 is, in certain cases, this can include the help of the sacraments. Hence, I want to remind priests that the confessional must not be a torture chamber, but rather an encounter with the Lord's mercy. So I hope when you go to confession, it's not a torture chamber. I really hope that's true. But Pope Francis means what he says, right? It's important to keep in mind. So from that same writing, another letter that he wrote before, The Joy of the Gospel, that's what that means in English, I would also point out that the Eucharist is not a prize for the perfect, but a powerful medicine and nourishment for the weak. Okay, so just to look at that for a moment, the article. So conditioning and mitigating factors, what is he talking about? Objective situation of sin. Very, very simply, you might remember if you learned it, you might have forgotten it, even if you learned it, but for a sin to be a sin, there has to be three things present, very simple. You might know what those are, you might not remember what those are, but the three things, for a sin that is for you to commit a sin, for a sin to be committed, you need to know that it's wrong, know that it's a sin that is, you need to choose to do it, and then you need to do it, those three things. So it doesn't mean that it's not a sin if you don't know it's a sin, or if you don't choose to do it, you just happen to do it because you're forced to, but that means that you're not culpable, and that's what that big word is that he's using, okay? So what he's saying, mitigating factors, objective situation of sin, a sin is a sin, okay? It's always wrong to kill someone, okay? But it's not wrong to kill someone if they are coming after you, okay? or someone else to protect yourself, okay? That's an example we always use with that. So that is always bad, it's always a serious sin, but that wouldn't be a culpable sin for you. That is, you would not be responsible for that sin, okay? So a person can be living in God's grace even if you committed, or not committed a sin, if you did something that was sinful but didn't commit a sin because you didn't know it was wrong, you didn't choose to do it, you still can live in God's grace, God's love, and can grow in the life of grace and surety, okay? So then he explains that. What does it mean to live in God's grace, God's life, which is grace, of course, and charity, love, with the church's help, okay? He talks about the sacraments. A sacrament is an outward sign instituted by Christ to give grace, right? That classic definition. Some of you know that, right? Okay, all right. Getting the best of time. Sorry. Okay. Give me a bat, a little bat with a cane or with your umbrella or something, okay? And let me know. All right. I don't want to come any closer. Some of you seem just so far back there. Anyway, so what this is saying right here, okay, we don't need explanation of what a torture chamber, we know what that is, and confession should not be that, right? And we all know that communion is not for the perfect, because no one here is perfect, right? But many of you hopefully go to communion. But it's a powerful medicine and nourishment for the weak. But what he's saying there is that sometimes, because the context of that chapter is talking about people that are married, but not in the church, okay? So we can call that a natural marriage, but it's not a sacramental marriage. So what he's saying is that if you're in that situation and don't know that it's different than being in a sacramental marriage, and that might seem a little far-fetched to you, how could someone who's Catholic not know that you're supposed to be married in the church? Well, I'm here to tell you, I've been a priest for 20 years. It happens all the time. Just like I said a few moments ago, you know what sin is? Well, maybe you did and you kind of forgot, or what makes a sin? Well, people might have learned it, people may have never learned it, that they should be married in the church. If you don't know it's wrong, you're not choosing to do it, and it's not a sin. Is it good to be married outside of the Catholic Church if you're Catholic without the grace of the sacrament? Of course not. He's not saying that. But what he's saying, even in that case, if you don't know, and I have encountered this in my 20 years as a priest, if you don't know, and you're in this situation, or you've been told by someone, like another priest, that it's okay, of course it's not, then there's no sin on your part. So that's what he's saying. So even in those cases, when the people go to communion, for example, that would not be a sin if they don't realize that they are supposed to be married in the church. Now, does that make sense? Okay. That's what he's saying. Now, what the media ran with here is they're saying, oh, it looks like he's saying you can receive communion no matter what. It doesn't matter if you're Catholic, or even if you're not Catholic, you can go to communion. It doesn't matter whether you're married in the church or not married. You can go. That's not what he's saying, but that's what the media said that he said. Okay? So that's a controversy with this document. That might not seem very exciting to you, but that was in the press probably for a good 2 to 2.5 months. I think it's finally cooled down after this document's been out a while, but that really got people's attention. But maybe it's not all bad that people are wondering what we really believe, what we really teach with the sacraments, especially marriage, because there's a lot of misunderstanding with all the sacraments and with much of our faith, okay? So that's a little controversy. We're putting that aside, all right? I don't know if that's controversial for you or if you're having a hard time accepting, well, did he really mean that? I can't speak for Pope Francis. I don't know exactly what he meant. It seems fair enough, but again, the media thought that they know, that they have this insight into his mind or soul. I'm not really sure, but that doesn't clearly mean that that's what he meant, and that's not what it says, okay? That's the controversy. Now, the other thing, right above that, again, if you are privileged to have one of these little sheets, there's a little bit of instruction by Pope Francis, if you're going to read this document, which I did, and I really encourage you to do, how to read it. Okay, so first of all, why did he write this document? He says, it represents an invitation to Christian families to value the gifts of marriage and the family, to persevere in love by strengthening the virtues of generosity, commitment, fidelity, and patience. It seeks also to encourage everyone to be a sign of mercy and closeness wherever family life remains imperfect or lacks peace and joy. Okay? So it's directed at families, but Pope Francis also wants you to understand, wants us to understand, when he speaks of family, he is thinking about people that are married, again, in the church with children, if they are blessed by God with children, but he is also speaking of the church. The church also is a family. The church is an institution, but first and foremost, it is the body of Christ. And one of the ways we could really best understand it, according to Pope Francis, and I believe he's right on with this, is a family. Now, we know what dysfunctional families are, right? And we know all of our families are dysfunctional in a certain sense. But the church, like dysfunctional families, sometimes could be a little rough, right? Here in this town and where I live in LaPorte, there's many churches. Maybe we don't need this many churches, right? But try to put these churches together. All I can say is, please pray for Father Kevin, your pastor, if you want to pray for all saints. And also I can say, please pray for Father Ian, if he's your pastor, if you go to any of the churches in LaPorte. All I have to do is show up and have mass. That's easy. He has to deal with every day. Why are they talking about closing the churches? Okay, that's not easy. But if we understand the church, not about the buildings, and the buildings are beautiful and important, but the church first and foremost, is a family, okay? So that's what he's saying this is for, but how to read it? He says, I do not recommend a rushed reading of the text, okay? You don't have it in front of you, I do, but this particular English translation of the document is 225 pages, okay? Don't rush through it. I don't know if anyone would try to rush through this, but he's saying, don't rush through it. And what he says there also is that when you're reading it, it might be helpful at first, before you get through the whole thing, and even after you do, to come to each part and read it patiently and carefully and pay attention to the parts dealing with specific needs, okay? So what I did is we're not going to look through this whole thing. It's too much. It's too long. It's worth reading the whole thing. I'm not saying forget about the rest of the document, but we're simply going to look at one of the chapters, okay? We're going to look at chapter 4, and chapter 4 starts with that passage from St. Paul that we just read together. Those of you who have that copy of the letter, or the paper that I handed out, rather. And this is a chapter entitled Love in Marriage, okay, if you don't have that paper in front of you. So it's really kind of the heart, in many ways, the heart of the document. It's by far the longest chapter. So what I'm going to do is just break it down for you a little bit and then offer a few comments, okay? So I'll tell you when Father Bill is speaking. I know that Father Bill is speaking right now. This is my voice. But what I'm going to be doing, just bear with me, is there's a lot of beautiful stuff in this document. And I know and I believe that you are on fire with the faith. Otherwise, why would you be here on a rainy night? But I also know that you might not get to read the entire document, okay? You might get through the first couple chapters or maybe the first couple pages and kind of give up, okay? That would be sad, but I'm a realist. I understand that that can happen. So I'm going to read a couple of the passages that I don't want you to miss, okay? That will be Pope Francis. Father Bill will read it. But then Father Bill will have a couple comments about that chapter and just a few more about the letter, okay? So are we all clear about that? Okay, because this is a lot and there's too much to do in one sitting. If you have four of these sessions that you do and they all talk about this document, it still wouldn't be enough, okay? So what we're going to do is, the first thing he does in that chapter is, after quoting St. Paul to the Corinthians, he goes line by line and he does do a little bit changing around with what Paul says, but I'll tell you when we see that, okay? And what we're going to do right now, then, is we're going to just look for a few moments at those passages, okay? So I'm going to do a little reading, so I know reading can be a little bit boring, but try to listen attentively, and just listen for the beauty of this document. It's amazing what he says. I'm sure you've heard this passage many times, and maybe you chose it if you're married for your wedding. Many couples did. But I think after hearing this, you're going to think about not only Corinthians, at least this passage from Corinthians, differently, but also you're going to have some new insights to marriage that you never had before. Okay, oh, and one last thing before we jump into that. So when we read things from popes, it doesn't mean that every word that Pope Francis or any of the other popes said is directly from the Holy Spirit, is directly from God, okay? Pope Benedict, in another book, this is for another time, okay? Another book that is recommended reading for every Catholic is Jesus of Nazareth. This is actually the first volume. There are three. But Pope Benedict said something that was very interesting at the time. It helps us not only understand his writings that he wrote during Pope, when his time as Pope, but also this writing and the other writings from Pope Francis, especially the ones that might seem controversial, but a little bit harder to understand, okay? So what he says here, he's writing about the life of Jesus, and he says, it goes without saying, but really it doesn't. He's saying that because he knows you don't know this, okay? This is Pope Benedict's book that he wrote, but it's just to understand a little bit better what to understand when you're reading from a pope. This isn't directly from the mouth of the Holy Spirit, okay? It goes without saying, even though it doesn't, that this book is in no way an exercise of the magisterium, but solely an expression of my personal search for the face of the Lord, okay? So he's very clear here. He's not speaking as Pope. He's speaking of Joseph as Joseph Ratzinger, okay? Now, it's not the same, really, as this. That book, Jesus of Nazareth, is not a papal document. This is, but even though this is a papal document, it doesn't mean that everything that Pope Francis writes in here or says, even when he speaks, is directly from God, okay? That's not a disrespect of the Pope, but Pope Benedict wanted us to be clear that it's not everything that comes directly from the mouth of God. Are we clear on that? Because some people, I think some Catholics, sometimes have that idea. All right, now jumping into the document, we're just going to look briefly at this passage from St. Paul and a couple of things that he says about these different lines, okay? Again, if you have that paper, you could just follow along because I just printed the lines for you. But I'm going to read a little bit what he said about each one, okay? So chapter 4 is Our Daily Love, okay? That's the title of the chapter. And then he goes through this passage from St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians. The first line being, love is patient, okay? What does that mean? According to Pope Francis, okay? So I'm going to tell you what I think Pope Francis means at the end, but what Pope Francis is telling you what he thinks St. Paul means. But I think he has a lot to say because he is Pope, right? And he is a brilliant man. He studied the scriptures a lot throughout his life. So, love is patient. What exactly does that mean? Its meaning is clarified in the Old Testament, Pope Francis says, in that God is slow to anger. God restrains his power as revealed in his acts of mercy. Mercy towards sinners, he says, is a sign of real power, okay? So sometimes we misunderstand or can misunderstand power in the church. Okay, the Pope has all this power. What he's saying and what he's saying, St. Paul is saying also, is real power is mercy, is the ability to forgive. And that includes not only others, but also the ability to include yourself, okay? So the next line, love is at the service of others. So, an interesting thing I never knew about this line is that this is the only time ever in the entire Bible, the Bible is a big book, right? The only time in the Bible that this phrase is used, love at the service of others, okay? Or love is kind, okay? That's how Pope Francis rephrases it. But love is kind never appears anywhere else. So, this attitude is not passive, but it's accompanied by activity. So it's not only interaction, but he says creative action with others. What does that mean? Love is more than a feeling, it is to do good. It all seems very simple to say love is kind, but it's another thing to actually do it creatively, as he says. Sometimes we have to be creatively, I think, because some people are more difficult than others, right? Some people take a little more creativity than love, but that's why we have to be creative. I think that's what he's saying there, okay? Love is not jealous or boastful, okay? Sincere esteem for every human being and the recognition of his or her own right to happiness is this meaning of St. Paul, okay? So, to be jealous is to let people be exactly as they are. You don't have to want what they are to be what they are. Let them be. Very simply, that's what to be, not be jealous is. Okay, the next line. Love is not boastful. What Pope Francis says to us about that is, love is marked by humility. And he understands humility as forgiving, serving others from the heart. And he says our pride has to be healed and our humility must increase, okay? So, in other words, it's about not only the other person, but when you have a problem with other people, it's because sometimes you're not humble. You think that the world revolves around you, and of course he's reminding us, as St. Paul says, it doesn't. Love is not rude, and Pope Francis simply adds, it's not arrogant or rude. So what that means, according to Pope Francis, is a kind look is essential. Now it seems simple, right? But he also adds, not just the kind look, but he also says, in our families, we must learn to imitate Jesus' gentleness in our way of speaking to one another. So, it seems simple, it seems commonsensical, but all we have to do, he's saying, not to be rude sometimes, to go extra for people, is to look kindly upon them, and also to watch the way you say what you say. It doesn't mean you have to not use words that our presidential candidates do. I'll just throw that out there, okay? But it's also your tone of voice, all right? The way you say things. If you've been around teenagers, and we all were there, right? You know what the attitude is about, right? Well, teenagers are not the only ones who have attitudes. Sometimes adults have lots of attitude. You might say something that's okay, but the way you say that is not okay. That's what he's saying, okay? Love is generous. What does it mean to be generous? The greatest of loves can lead to laying down one's life for another. He simply quotes the Gospel of John. This is what Jesus did. That doesn't mean you have to actually be on the cross, but to really go out of your way and do things for others, that's what laying down your life is. Okay. Love is not irritable or resentful. What the Pope says about that, he says, St. Paul is saying, our first reaction when we get annoyed should be one of heartfelt blessing, asking God to bless, free, and heal that person. So we might want to say something else or react a different way, but instead of saying something else, we say, bless you, right? As opposed to something else. Or sometimes, instead of saying anything, just holding back, okay? Hold that thought, because when you think about it, it's not such a good thought. It's not such a Christ-like thought, right? This is kind of fun, isn't it? Pope Francis knows how to have fun, even with the scriptures, okay? You can have fun with the scriptures of the Word of God. Love forgives is the next one. And what he says about love forgives, or forgiving, is forgiveness is a positive attitude that seeks to understand other people's weaknesses and excuse them. As Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, okay? So we all know that other people have faults and foibles, but it's another thing to overlook them and another thing to really forgive them. And remember, when we talk about forgiveness as God forgives, or biblical forgiveness, that means forgetting. So as he just quoted Jesus saying on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. Jesus is asking that your and my sins, which put him on the cross, are not only forgiven, but forgotten. So that's not exactly the kind of forgiveness that we're good at, but that's the kind of forgiveness that St. Paul, that God is inviting us to have, according to Pope Francis. Love rejoices with others. So what that means, very simply, talking about the family, Pope Francis says, the family must always be a place where when something good happens to one, others will be there to celebrate it with them. So what he's doing, he's contrasting. He said, love is not jealous. That's what St. Paul says. But now he says, love rejoices, okay? Love rejoices in the truth. That's actually what St. Paul says. And he simply says, love rejoices. And that what it means is not simply to not be down on people and take advantage of them when they do dumb things or when they're not at their best, or to throw that back in their face, but to really rejoice, to be happy as if it was you. If someone gets an award, if someone gets some kind of recognition or attention, be happy for that person. Don't be jealous, well, why does that happen to me? I deserve that more. No, it's really not about you. To be generous, of course, to be rejoicing in generosity, as St. Paul is talking about here, is to be focused on others, not focused on yourself. Love bears all things. So what he's saying, or as he endured, love endures all things, as Pope Francis is saying too, is very simply, It recognizes that failings are part of a bigger picture, okay? Love coexists with imperfection, okay? So to endure everything doesn't mean just to love people when they're lovable, or to love the good things about them. And this is what he's saying with marriage, but with all relationships, we have to love the whole person, and we have to love the whole person all the time. Now, that's a tall order, right? St. Paul is saying a lot, and Pope Francis is asking a lot of us, but of course he's reminding us that these are not really his words, he's commenting on his words, and they're not really even St. Paul's words to the Corinthians. They are God's word. They're inspired by the Holy Spirit. Again, not everything you hear, every word that he's written is inspired, but we know when it comes to the scriptures, it really is God's word. It's not easy, but we have to be, as Pope says, creative, okay? So after that, he has this little section in that chapter, growing in conjugal or marital love. Conjugal means the love of husband and wife, okay? So just a few words about that. Sorry to keep turning through this document, but I want to make sure you get the real words. These are not Father Bill's words, okay? These are Pope Francis' words, okay? So in the second, there's all these different sections. I just put them on that paper for you. We're skipping over the first one to the second one. In paragraph 129, not that anyone has the document in front of them, but if you did, you could follow. The joy of love needs to be cultivated. Since we were made for love, we know that there is no greater joy than the sharing of good things. Give, take, and treat yourself well, he quotes from the Old Testament. The most intense joys in life arise when we are able to elicit joy in others as a foretaste of heaven. So, I think that's saying a lot, right? The most intense joys in life arise when we are able to elicit joy in others as a foretaste of heaven. So, he's comparing the joy that others bring to you and the joy that you bring to them with heaven. A lot of people have asked me, what will heaven be like? Well, he's saying we'll get an idea about that when we bring joy to others. Okay, I mentioned teenagers, not to be down on them, I'm not, but children have this amazing ability to be happy about everything. Sometimes so much that it's kind of annoying that they're always happy about everything, right? I don't know why, but that true joy that they have, and it's the real thing, they're not making up that joy, they are who they are, their children, that comes from the fact, perhaps, that they're so close from God. That's my theory, anyway. They haven't had time to get cynical and jaded and pessimistic and to look at things as half full. Okay, there's lots of things to be sad about in our world. Someone just told me a few moments ago, well, the world is a lot worse off than it was before, okay? I'm not sure about that. But instead of saying that, we could say a different thing. How can I bring more joy into the world? No one here in this room is running for president. I'd be afraid of that one, right? Just like you are for the ones. But you don't have to do that to bring joy into the world. All you have to do, and this is, we just, not long ago, we had the feast of St. Mother Teresa. And Mother Teresa once said, because someone asked her, he was working with her for a while in India, and he was going back to home to his family, and he's like, well, Mother Teresa, this has been an amazing experience, you changed my life, but what can you say that I could bring back to my family? How can I bring this joy and this faith that you have here, serving the poor, how can I bring that to others, especially to my own family? And she said, it's very simple. What you need to do is you need to start by smiling at your wife. And then what he did is he laughed at Mother Teresa. And Mother Teresa was a little surprised, like, why are you laughing at me? And he said, he just shook his head. He said, Mother Teresa, you're a great person. I love you, but you don't have any idea what it's like to be married. I never said that to you, especially to my wife. And then Mother Teresa stopped him in his tracks and was very serious, as she could be, very stern, as it were, and said, no, I do understand. I am married to Jesus, and sometimes he asks too much from me. We didn't know at that point, but what we know now about her life is that for most of her life, the majority of her life, she was in a spiritual place called dryness or darkness. That she had no sensation of God's presence whatsoever. It seemed like God was not listening to her prayer, that God didn't care. But she smiled anyway, not just at God by continuing her prayer, but also at others. And people, that's one thing that inspired me. When she was alive, I thought, how is someone happy like her all the time? She wasn't. But you gotta fake it till you make it. You gotta have that smile, and that smile. But you know what that tells us, an amazing thing, I think, is what this is saying to us, is that you can bring joy, you can make someone happy, even when you're sad, even when you're not happy. And of course, by seeing that joy, that foretaste of heaven that you bring to someone else, that's going to bring that joy, it's going to reflect it back to you. Okay? This is maybe not the way that we work, but the world would be different, wouldn't it, if we tried this? If we really were serious about that? Okay, so another section in here, in the second part of our chapter 4, is called dialogue, okay? In paragraph 136, we read these words, and this is a little bit long, okay? But this is beautiful, okay? Dialogue is another word for communication, and that's where everything stands or falls in a marriage, but not just in a marriage, but in a relationship. If you're not communicating, then you're wasting time. You gotta try it, you gotta work through those difficult times, even if it means arguing, right? So dialogue, what does he say? Men and women, young people and adults communicate differently. Wow, that's an understatement, isn't it? We can say a lot about that, we won't. They speak different languages. I like how he puts that, right? And they act in different ways. One way of asking and responding to questions, the tone we use, back to that tone, right? Our timing and any number of other factors condition how we communicate. We need to develop attitudes that express love and encourage authentic dialogue. I think that we're back to being creative, right? Not easy, but we gotta do that. And he says also, take time, quality time. I know from experience, so many problems happen in relationships, marriage or otherwise, it's because people don't have time for each other. That's what they say. But what it really is we're saying that other things are more important. Other people, maybe our work, maybe our hobbies, those are more important, or else the truth is, you don't wanna deal with that person. So that's why we're not spending time with them. But he says, take time, quality time. Put yourself into this. This means being ready to listen patiently and attentive to everything the other person wants to say. You might think, this is evidence that Pope Francis is crazy, right? Well, you can say that if you want, but this is what he's saying. It requires the self-discipline of not speaking until the time is right. Not easy, right? Instead of offering an opinion or advice, people don't need your opinion, right, or your advice. We need to be sure that we have heard everything the other person has to say. This means cultivating interior silence that makes it possible to listen to the other person without mental or emotional distractions, okay? So this is not easy. This is tough stuff, but he's helping us understand how can we get from where we are to where we need to be. And again, he's not just talking about marriage. He's talking about all of us. All of us need work on our relationships, right? I know I do. All of us do, okay? So the next section, that just looking at a few lines together, is paragraph 149, which is in the section, The World of Emotions. Hold with me, I know. This is not exciting. Do you have someone read with you? Read to you. You're not little kids. You know how to read. I understand that. But I think it's really important that we hear what Pope Francis has to say. And this is something that this next passage is very good to think about. As a true man, and I emphasize that word, man, Jesus showed his emotions. You men are always not known for really showing our emotions very much, right? But this is what he's saying. Jesus showed his emotions. He was hurt by the rejection of Jerusalem, and this moved him to tears. Some say that real men don't cry. That's not what Jesus said, okay? He also was moved deeply by the suffering of others. He felt deeply their grief and wept at the death of a friend. It would be Lazarus. You remember that passage, okay? The shortest verse in Scripture is Jesus wept when Lazarus had died. These examples of Jesus' sensitivity showed how much his human heart was open to others. Experience of an emotion is not in itself morally good or evil, okay? So I think what he's saying is two extremes here. We could be overly emotional, we call that dramatic. Does anyone know any dramatic? drama queens or drama queens. There's lots of drama there, right? We could do that, or we could be unemotional. Oh, I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. And holding it, bottling it in, until what happens? Then you explode, okay? You call that passive aggressive, and that doesn't help anyone, okay? Are you sure you're not angry with me? No, no, everything's fine. Well, if you're answering that way, probably everything isn't, okay? But emotions are not the be-all, end-all, but they're not bad because God made them, okay? So what he's saying is just basically own your emotions. So we're almost done here, folks, with the reading. I know you're being very patient, and I appreciate that. Okay, so from that, there's a few more sections. The erratic dimension of love. That sounds like fun, doesn't it? So erratic dimension of love, paragraph 115. Very simply, God himself created sexuality, which is a marvelous gift to his creatures. So it's important for us to keep in mind that not only sexuality is a gift, it's not a burden, it's not a curse, it's not a temptation. It's a gift, but it's a gift that God himself created. God created all of our gifts, right? But it's important for us to hear those words, I think. It's a marvelous gift, as he says, to his creatures. Not a small gift, but a great gift. It's a gift like all gifts that could be misused and abused. We know about that. But it's a marvelous gift from God. And also, about sexuality, and of course, this is especially about marriage, so we're not saying that we're left out if we're not married, but this is what he's focusing on here in this section. He also says in paragraph 152, and this is important for us to remember too, sexuality is not a means of gratification or entertainment. It's a language, an interpersonal language where the other is taken seriously in his or her sacred and viable dignity. As a passion sublimated by love, respectful of the dignity of the other, it becomes pure, unadulterated affirmation, revealing the marvels of which the human heart is capable. So that might seem that Pope Francis is dreaming the impossible dream with this. Is this really true? Is this really possible? And I think the answer we have to believe is yes. It's not easy, but it means if you're married, to find that place with each other. If you're the husband, if you're the wife, you're going to have different needs because we speak different languages, as the Pope says, okay, in more ways than one. But part of that is communication. Sexuality is communication in marriage. That's one of the ways, a very, very magnificent and important way, as the Pope was pointing out, that couples communicate not just their love, but it's very important, is making the communication, or the connection here in his communication with us, that it is God's love that's communicated in that act, okay? Like I said, we're almost finished here. So we're into the section of marriage and virginity. And this is a little interesting, that's why I read it, but I think it's important for us to know not everyone is married out there. I'm not, okay? Sister's not, I know. This is the last time I checked, all right? So a little word to understand that, okay? People might not understand why I should get married in the church, but a lot of people understand why shouldn't everyone get married, okay? Because it's not our vocation. But what does he say about that? The value of virginity lies in symbolizing a love that has no need to possess the other. In this way, it reflects the freedom of the kingdom of heaven. Okay, so it's not saying anything bad about marriage, okay? This whole document is a beautiful treatment on, well, married love and other married, or other kinds of love. But what that's saying about virginity or celibacy for us who are called to it is that there is a freedom that we have, okay? Now, it's a freedom not to be all wrapped up in ourselves, which can happen, right? Because we don't worry about a spouse, because we don't worry about children, we don't have to. We're not with them all the time. But that isn't so that I have more time for me, the sister has more time for her. What that is, means that we have more time for you, okay? And people, a lot of people have asked, this is not in the document, okay? But many, many people have asked, okay, Father, what is your opinion on married priests? Shouldn't you be allowed to be married? And after thinking about this for many years, my answer to that is, no, I don't think so. If I was married, something would have to come first, either my wife and children, or the people that I'm called to serve, like right now in the hospital, or when I'm in parishes having mass, you, okay? So you can't do both, okay? You're only one person. So one thing suffers. Either your marriage falls apart and you're not with your kids,
or you're just not with the people that God has called you to minister to in the hospital, the parish, wherever God calls you to, okay? So it's very important for us to see that there's a freedom there. But I say that also because that freedom can be abused by ourselves if we're selfish, if we have selfish vocations, but also by you, not intentionally, but when you're always saying, Father, 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 can I remind you that the pastor of Cathedral of All Saints is by himself, okay? He's one priest. He could only do, one person could do it one time, and he has three churches, right? But he's one priest, one person at one time, okay? Father Ian, if any of you, I see a couple of you from the court, he is one priest. He has three parishes, right? But he's only one person to do one thing at a time. And I know it's happening to me. Oh, Father, you got to take care of yourself, but I need you to do this, or can you do this for me? Without taking a breath, okay? You're not meaning to be mean. It's unintentional, but that would be an abuse of our vocation. Now, we have to say no. Sometimes we're not good about that. But also, you have to realize that we're limited, okay? And not just because there's fewer in number, but also sometimes means that Father or sister or whoever can't do that for you, but maybe sometimes you could do that, or you could do more than you're doing. Or you should talk to this person, you should help that person. Maybe you should try to talk to that person and help them first, and then go to Father Kevin or Father Ian or Sister Cheryl or Father Bill. And if you do, that's going to make not only our lives a little bit better and brighter, but also it's going to help you realize that you're called by your baptism to do what we do. All of us are called to be holy, to serve. We have a little more freedom in some ways than you do, but we can't do everything for everyone. Okay, so a little bit about virginity there. Then, of course, he says about marriage. Another beautiful thing he says about marriage here is that conjugal or marital love symbolizes the full unity and distinction found in the Trinity. The family is a sign of Christ, okay? So to say that marriage is a symbol of the Trinity is, I think it's good to use this word, mystery, right? The Trinity is a mystery. How do we understand three gods in one person? I can't explain that to you. However, we do have an image on earth of the Trinity. I didn't know this until a few years ago, and I don't know how I missed this in catechism or in Catholic school that I went to. I'm not sure. Maybe they didn't say that, but this is a beautiful image. He doesn't say this here, but this whole idea of the Trinity as family is something we can relate to also, not only because we have our families, which are dysfunctional, like I said before, but there's one family that isn't dysfunctional, or wasn't, and that is the Holy Family. Now, you might say that is a unusual family, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, but that is an example of the Trinity on earth. It's not exactly the same as the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, but there was as perfect a love between a mother and a father and a child as there can be between those three people. And that is what love is. That's what the Trinity is. It's a relationship. It's a perfect human relationship. And marriage is the image of that self-giving love of Christ for his church. That's what Pope Francis is saying, okay? Again, he's reflecting on St. Paul, but I really think that that is right on. I think that is what St. Paul meant to say. In other words, what the Holy Spirit is saying to us through St. Paul and through Pope Francis. Okay, one last thing, one little passage, okay? So the last part is transformation in love, okay? Paragraph 163. I don't know why I'm saying that because you don't have it in front of you, but if you did, okay? So, the love a couple pledges is greater than any emotion, feeling, or state of mind. Again, it's not about emotion, he's saying, right? Although it may include all of these, it's a deeper love, a lifelong decision of the heart. Even amid unresolved conflicts and confused emotional situations, the couple daily reaffirms their decision to love, to belong to one another, to share their lives, and to continue loving and forgiving. Each husband and wife progresses along the path of personal growth and development. On this journey, love rejoices at every step and in every stage. And finally, he says, the marriage bond finds new forms of expression and constantly seeks new ways to grow in strength. These both preserve and strengthen the bond of love. They call for daily effort. None of this is possible without praying to the Holy Spirit for an outpouring of his grace, his supernatural strength, and his spiritual fire, to confirm, direct, and transform our love in every new situation. So, if you're married or were married or knows married couples, you might be thinking to yourself what that man thought when he talked to Mother Teresa many years ago. Pope Francis doesn't get it, does he? He's not married. That's very clear. This is not possible. This is dream language, right? This is crazy to think that any couple could be like that. You might be thinking that, and I think that's fair to think. But again, that last thing that he shared with us is where the rubber hits the road, is where it comes together or it doesn't. How is this possible? It isn't possible for a married couple to do this. It isn't. I acknowledge that, and he's acknowledging that. He doesn't say that you could do this, but what he does say is, none of this is possible, he just said that, right, without praying to the Holy Spirit for an outpouring of his grace, his supernatural strength, his spiritual fire, to confirm, direct, and transform our love in every situation. So, that's where it all comes together. If we pray, okay, it's all going back, it's all referring, once again, reminding us of that need to be in relationship. Marriage is a relationship, right? Family that he's talking about in this document also is a relationship, many relationships. But it's all based on if it's true, if it's a great marriage, if it's a wonderful, functional family, a loving marriage, a family that knows how to love and get along with each other, that's all founded on the fact that you know that you're loved. And the way that you know that you're loved, he says many parts, in many places in this letter, is if you know God's for you. And there's only one way you can know that. I can tell you, and I'll tell you again, God loves you. But for you to really believe that, for you to really know that, you have to find that. And where do you find that? You find it certainly in God's word that he's reflecting on. You find it in prayer. And the Holy Spirit comes upon all of us. And again, he is talking about marriage, about many other things. He's giving special attention to marriage in this letter. But how is it that a marriage could be changed from a broken or dysfunctional or divided or an abusive marriage to the loving marriage that is God's plan? The way is you call upon the Holy Spirit by calling upon the grace of the sacrament. If you are married, again in the church, some people don't understand the difference, but if you are married, you are married before a priest or a deacon in a church, okay? Call upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you received in baptism, right? Confirmation, and also in your marriage. I don't know that people know that. I don't know that people do that, but I think that marriage would look a little bit different if people really tried that. Now, he does say in another part of this document, we have to acknowledge also that it's an amazing thing that some couples, it just doesn't work out, and they need to separate. But the way that we see their love expressed is that even when they separate, they still do whatever they can to take care of and to look after that other person. They can't live with them, they can't be married to them, but they still love them, okay? That's the real deal, that's love. So sometimes it doesn't work out, he acknowledges that, but when it does, the reason it does is because God is there, okay? Marriage is always a relationship between three people. And if you're married, you know what I'm talking about. Marriage, happily married in the Catholic Church. It's not just you and your spouse, but first and foremost, it is God, okay? And if you know that, and if you are reminded of that each day by your prayer and call upon the grace of the sacrament, nothing will separate you, as St. Paul says in another part of Corinthians, from that love of Christ, okay? And those promises are good to remember, right? These are not my words that Father Bill is speaking, okay? But these are the words that you spoke if you were married in the church. You promised to be true to each other. How does it go? In good times and in bad, in sickness and in health, for richer or for poorer, till death do we part. Okay, so you know these words. Don't let them just be words. You know what they are. You know what the words are. Now it's time to ask God to help you to live them. You might say, well, Father, it might have been good to know a little bit more about this when I was married a few years ago. Where were you then? Where was Pope Francis? Why did he write this letter back then? Okay. God has a plan, right? I don't know why it didn't happen back then, but it's happening today. This is an invitation to you. And I'm not just talking to married couples, okay? To all of us. If we go to the Holy Spirit, if we call upon God, remember God, who is love, that's what God says about God, right?
God's word, the Bible tells us, Jesus himself said, God is love. What does that mean? That means that he wants you to know that you are loved. And you will if you talk to him. Talking to him is like talking to this wall sometimes. I know he doesn't talk back, but it really does change your life. And if you pray, you know what I'm talking about. And every married couple that's been married a long time, happily, and it doesn't mean there's not ups and downs, there always are. There are in religious life too, right, sister? There certainly are in the priesthood, okay? But if you stick with it, if you have that perseverance, that's a sign that you know that you're not doing it by yourself. And I'm not just talking about that person that you have been married to, but that person that maybe both of you know, and that person would be God the Holy Spirit. So, those are just a couple of my words, my reflection on that beautiful document. And again, there's so much richness in there. I think we've gotten past the controversy. It doesn't take that much, really, okay? But take your time. This is what Pope Francis says to read it. First of all, get it. You can look at it on the computer. You can look at it on the Vatican website. But the thing is, if you get it in printed form, I don't know about you, but I read better when it's actually printed. And it's a long document, so I don't want your eyes to suffer. And you have to go to the eye doctor because you read Pope Francis' letter. You still get a lot out of it, right? But I just recommend that you actually, you can download it too. That's a lot of paper. It might be telling you more trees than necessary. But you can simply go to, there's a certain store in this town. There's a store that sells it. I can't remember the name offhand. That person might be here from the store too. You might find a store where you can get that in all of the Pope's letters that are published. Okay. So, I don't know if we have time for questions or not, but I can't really answer anyone's question in the back because you probably can't answer. Can't get past this magic line, right? So. But I mean, okay, it's a lot to take in, and I read a lot to you, and I really appreciate your patience with that because it's really easy to glaze over after the first minute of that and to tune it out, but it's dynamite. It's an amazing letter that he wrote. And I know some people don't like Pope Francis. Well, of course, some people also, I love Pope Francis, and I also love Pope Benedict. Some people didn't like him, even though he's a saint and he's in heaven. Some people didn't like St. John Paul II. Some people didn't like St. John the 23rd. We just celebrated his feast yesterday, right? But it doesn't matter whether you like them or not. God is not asking you to like the Pope, but just read it. Give him a chance. And it will help you in your life, and it will help you to help some other people's lives too. And the best part is it's not over yet. You have two more of these, right? Two more documents to look at. So I know that Father Jerry, probably said some of the same things about the Pope last week if you were here. So I apologize about repeating everything he did. But just a few thoughts on that wonderful letter. But please try to read it. Okay? Thank you.
Can he step away from the line now? Can he step away now?
Yeah, he can. He's not freely now.
We want to thank you guys again for coming out tonight.